And what we said to him was, well, we need somebody to teach us how to sail. We've got a delivery job.
He said, are you working just now?
You can either come out and teach us to sail, or you can come and do delivery, whatever.
They were willing to offer £1,000.
Just get us out at Marina, please, you know.
Took probably about 30 seconds hesitation before I said, yes. Dennis was pleased to see me. Now there was somebody who knew about these strange sailing boats.
I don't like it. I just don't like the boat.
The knowledge of this subject was sadly lacking.
It had sails on and stuff like that. I don't understand that. I just wasn't happy on the thing.
Basically, within 30 seconds of my arrival on the deck, I let out a speech of horror.
Donald was freaking. He was saying, oh no, look, look. You've got, I don't know what they call them, but the mast was about to fall down.
It could have very easily all ended in tragedy.
Oh, what are you doing, you know? So that's why you're here.
Frank came on board.
And we set off to Malta.
There was a considerable amount of enthusiasm on that first day.
This guy knew what he was doing, you know. This guy's good.
I actually thought this is going to work. But fairly quickly after leaving the island, various things about the whole attitude to the trip that made me think that the sailing was not the primary object of the exercise.
I mean, you can't teach a monkey to play a chess, can you?
The suspicions had been growing. There was something about the whole approach that made me think that there was something perhaps a little dodgy about the entire enterprise. Frank began to make noises about what would you do if you could get a really nice sum of money. And this began to ring alarm bells. The weather began to deteriorate as we were approaching Malta. By that time, the enthusiasm was rapidly failing. Certainly for Frank, who just happened to be on the helm at the time. Frank became a little bit upset about being thrown around.
The weather was bad, so what could we do? I think he wanted Donald to pick the boat up and carry it.
He was beside himself, suggested that I really needed to do something about this motion, because if I didn't, he would throw me over the side. Doubts began to creep into my mind then. Why did you buy a sailing boat? What was the purpose of this boat?
I think it had a good idea that there was something going wrong here, you know, there's something out of order.
He began to say, have you realised that we're not just wanting to learn to sail? We've actually got something naughty planned here. We intend to take the boat across the Atlantic and to pick up a consignment of drugs. Cocaine. He said that I would be paid £40,000. I had visions of large squads of police scurrying about and armed drug dealers in South America. He said, you are now party to information that, let's face it, is extremely dangerous. Should I do something that caused this operation to be blown? Should I cross this operation? Then there was no place in the world to hide. The decision had to be yes. It was the beginning of a nightmare. A nightmare which has continued ever since.
Tesco Mobile Extra Tariff. Top up just £15 a month and you could text 300 people at 5p a go. Or call 150 people at 10p a minute. Or even call a loved one for 2.5 hours. Tesco Mobile. Every little helps.
In the cool of the evening, everything is getting kind of groovy. I'm gonna tell you all, as my heart's been a-dying to be saved.
3 pints of Carlsberg.
Carlsberg don't do nightclubs, but if we did, they'd probably be the best nightclubs in the world. Introducing new Carlsberg Edge, naturally brewed with citrus.
for serious refreshment.
At hmv.co.uk, you'll find great deals on music, DVDs and games.
Women, don't expect any help on a Tuesday. Nuts about women, motors, sport, read nuts. This week, only 70p.
Ginsters, real honest food.
If you're receiving tax credits and your life changes, tell us as quickly as possible. Because changes to your working hours or income, for example, could change the amount you should receive. And if you don't report a change, you could receive more than you're entitled to. And the longer that happens, the more money you'll have to pay back. So call us. Don't put it off. Tax credits. Make sure you're right on the money.
Two friends are about to put the force
back into nature's control.
Open season.
I come in peace.
This is the story of helping your personal details stay safe. Get 25% off selected fellow shredders. Don't shop for it, Argos it.
So we're all alone, la 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 la.
Aren't conversations magical? Like walking through someone's thoughts. And the beauty of this is that you get to know each other better. That's why with Orange Pay As You Go, you can talk to your Orange Magic number for an hour and pay just 15p. And you can add another friend every 6 months.
The plan.
My involvement was purely to skipper the boat.
Sail out in the Mediterranean, go down to the Caribbean.
And then enjoy myself in the sun. I would have no involvement whatsoever in the handling of the drugs.
And then get the phone call and go and pick up the drugs.
This well-oiled machine would be put in place.
Payday. Bye-bye. See you later.
Straightforward. No problem at all.
Slick. Yeah. Super slick.
We finally lost sight of the islands just as the sun was going down that evening. And then the realization kind of sunk into the guys that this was the last time they would see land for anything up to a month. Almost from that point on, there's no going back. It was just really a growing sense of impending doom. Dennis was aware of the clash of personalities between Frank and I. Frank had a great deal of underlying aggression.
I weren't happy. I didn't want to be on water break for it. Because it was just like a bad atmosphere, you know?
It must have made things very difficult for him, but he tried to remain neutral.
Frank and I are old friends. We're old friends. I'd have done anything for him, and I think he'd have done anything for me. It was a normal day. I was working. Up pops Frank. How are you doing? I'm seeing you for a while. What's going on? You fancy coming sailing? Straight out of the blue. Yeah, offer me £40,000. £40,000 cash in your hands is a lot of money. But you could have offered me a bag of chips, I think I'd have gone, you know what I mean? I was a good mate. And a good mate, you know? What happens on a boat, you get into like a routine. You work 4 hours, you sleep 8 hours. Rather than the first night, I couldn't get it. I just couldn't work out what was happening here, you know. My head was going in bits.
They really felt this trip was just going to be an endless nightmare of feeling absolutely exhausted all the time.
We got seasick. We got sick of the sea. The scenery was, you know, the same. You couldn't play I Spy or anything, because it was I Spy with my little eye, something with B. Well, that's both SSC and Cloud, you know what I mean? That was it.
Just really resigned to getting on, getting over there and getting done with it. We really kept the whole thing under wraps, if you like. Once land was sighted, as a sailor there's a sense of quiet satisfaction.
I remember being happy. I remember being sat on the boat thinking, wow, that's alright, you know what I mean, there's land at last, you know what I mean. I'm going to have a shower.
I think Frank and Dennis felt quite proud of themselves that they had survived this endurance exercise.
Got to Antigua. One piece, I think we did it in 23 days.
Seem to remember Frank saying, yeah, you know, well done, skipper, yeah, you've brought us across here.
Just as we went to the marina, comes in this aeroplane, Lufthansa, the German. My mate looks up and says, that's good timing. He said, I couldn't have done that any better. Couldn't have done what? What girlfriend's on that? What girlfriend? Oh, German bird. Off he goes, like 20 seconds after landing, off he goes, we're up money we had, and goes to an hotel with his bird. When he went off with his missus, we had to give him every single penny we had. Everything.
Dennis was becoming less and less confident in the whole operation.
I think he did 2 weeks five-star in his big luxury hotel. We didn't even get a sniff, you know what I mean? We've got no food. Well, there's us going for like 20 or 30 million pounds worth of drugs and we had no food on the boat, you know?
I certainly was making noises. Was there some way that we could bring this to an end? Did we have to continue with this? With his nightmare. He said, were I to run away from this situation, or to attempt to, that had only one conclusion, my death. As we were sailing to Margarita, Frank announced that we would need to make preparations for the drugs. He had made it clear from the beginning that it was a sizable quantity.
Oh dear. Like, where am I going to put the stuff, you know what I mean? You can't just put it like behind cushions, can you?
There were some 5 internal water tanks.
We just threw them overboard. We drained a diesel tank, then we could actually take the diesel tank out. We could put the stuff below the diesel tank, put the diesel tank on top. That was our preparation.
Probably the last water tank was jettisoned when we had the coast of Margarita in sight, and after that we anchored in Polomar Bay.
What a dump. Absolute dump. Just horrible. Horrible place. And that was just first impressions. We later found out that it really was horrible, you know, it wasn't just first impressions. So we actually moved out into a hotel, I think, the first day.
For me, it was extremely strange behaviour and very unusual for cruising yachtsmen to be leaving the boat as soon as it got into harbour and heading off to live in a hotel. This was unusual, attention-grabbing behaviour.
We were promised we'd get a 2-day turnaround. My man went away to make the phone calls, come back, right, couple of days, sorted, we'll be away. So
we then really went into a waiting mode.
I mean, we started getting nervous because the lights started coming.
We began to run into weeks.
That's gone from him being my mate who had always welcomed at my house, which I have welcomed at my house, and helped him when he was stuck, to absolutely not wanting him within a million miles of me. So it got pretty bad. And we've been there a long time. I think after about 5 weeks, my mate says, I'm a drama, and a real drama. My wife's got cancer in her breast.
There was huge sympathy for the situation that Frank told us he found himself in.
Donald lost his dad through cancer. I lost my mum through cancer. We know what it is, you know. I mean, what would anybody do? Get on your way. Get out of Margarita. Go home.
And of course he should go back to Britain.
We actually paid for his tickets and all that rubbish. It cost a fair few quid to get him out of the country. Don.
I really had a fairly clear idea that was the last time that I would ever see Frank.
It turns out there's nothing wrong with his wife, you know what I mean? Just not wrong with her. She was right as rain. What we were doing, we were actually waiting for the phone call. Just wait for the phone call. Do what the phone call says. Nothing else. I'd sort of got the feeling that we're being watched. But I don't know if it was paranoia. I was pretty sure that we're being watched. We had a funny feeling that, yes, what was going on.
At the beginning of May, the phone finally rang.
And he said, can you please put the car on this certain car park? Do you know where it is? Yep. So I drove away, put the car on the car park, put the keys on top of the wheel, which you've got to do a bit. You know what I mean? Make James Bond back.
24 hours later, it would be ready for collection at the same point with the drug on board. The same process would be repeated during the following 24 hours. At that point, there was a sense of increasing dread, really, that this was the crunch.
It's becoming real, yeah?
There were many times when I thought about just cutting loose and trying to get away, but each time I was brought short by the realization that if I escape today and a week later, these lads are in prison. They are going to think we are in prison because the guy that left us last week has talked.
If this comes off, we're Superman. That night, once I'd actually dropped the car off, I mean, it just wasn't a happy night, you know. I think, I don't know if I don't think I slept.
I didn't sleep a great deal that night, no. There was a constant sense of dread.
Do you run away? And if you run away, it's your fault, it's gone wrong. Maybe want to.
This might be the last night of freedom.
I think that night is when I really realised that what a disaster was going to be for my family.
I just couldn't begin to imagine just what my daughter's reaction would be. What effect it would have on her life. Whichever direction I looked, there were problems of darkness.
I didn't have enough money to fly out. I didn't have enough airfare to fly away.
Have you lost your mind? What is going on here? What are you doing?
So where am I going to run to? I'm just going to do it. Just going to do it.
When I looked in the back, I just shook my head.
We've been told it'd be bagged, it'd be boxed, it'd be something that'd be not obviously what it was, you know?
Because the bags were open weave, you could see that each bag was filled with blocks of a white substance.
You had a big ace of clubs on. You could see them through, didn't you? And then unless you were right, you know what were in it, you know what I mean? It was so obvious, through windows. Been promised to be tidy, you know, we could carry it off and people weren't going to go, oh, look what they're doing, you know? You could see everything what was going on, and it was just stacked everywhere, it was everywhere.
I said to Dennis, look, why don't we just take this down the main street of Paloma and hand it out the windows to passers-by until somebody comes along and stops us, because to all intents and purposes, that's what's going to happen anyway. This is just crazy.
one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. Oh boy. Houston, we have a problem.
Oh, geez. You drink a Red Bull. Red Bull gives you wings.
What should we do?
Well, nothing. Come back to Earth and we'll shoot the whole thing in the studio.
Okay.
What's that then?
Oh, it's a new cereal from Weetabix. But it's made with oats instead of wheat. It's called Not Made From Wheat, Made From Oats Instead, a Bix.
Sounds nice.
They should have called it Otabix. New Otabix. It's utterly different.
Cold sores? I hate how they feel and look. When I feel one, I want it gone. Fast.
Think fast. Think Zavarax. It starts to work immediately. Nothing fights the virus faster.
So I'm my real self again. Fast.
Think fast. Think Zavarax.
Close your eyes and count to ten.
A door has been opened. Now the terror is out. The Grudge 2.
Here's something that might surprise you. In a survey of over 12,500 people, Herbal Essences Rainforest Flowers shampoos and conditioners were voted Product of the Year 2006. Not only do they smell great, they leave your hair sleek, sensuous, and smooth.
Yes! Yes! Yes!
Now they sound like very satisfied customers. Herbal Essences Rainforest Flowers, Product of the Year 2006.
Herbal!
The best mashed potato, made with rich double cream. The best pork, blossom honey, and whole grain mustard sausages. The best onion gravy, with red wine and thyme. The best bangers and mash. The best range from Morrison's. Exceptional food for every day. More reasons to shop at Morrison's.
Find out what it feels like when you find the job you want. Monster has tens of thousands of jobs posted online, making it a great place for you to search, apply, and find your perfect job. So add your CV and start applying for new jobs today on monster.co.uk.
We're all busy, and cooking a meal from scratch isn't always practical.
Burgers from the shops are a quick solution, but are they made with the same ingredients you'd use at home?
Some are, but then some contain E301 or sodium metabisulfite,
and that's a preservative.
In the 18th century, they stored their food using nature's preservative. Nothing artificial, just ice. And that's one ingredient we've all got at home.
100% beef burgers, 0% preservatives. Bird's Eye, five-star food, frozen.
At the Curry sale, save £200 on this Samsung stainless steel side-by-side fridge freezer, now £599. So bag a bargain today.
Donald then decides he wants to pay another day's marina fees. God knows why.
I went into the harbour office and one thing that did catch my attention when I was there was that it was a strange looking radio. It was a VHF radio, but it was not a marine VHF radio.
No, I'm driving back, it was, you know, this is it now.
While the forms were being filled in and I was paying the money, which would have been around the time that Dennis arrived with the car in front of the boat, the radio began to jabber something in Spanish in a fairly excited voice.
I think if they'd weighed £1 million each, or a ton each, they'd have gone on that boat. You know, I just wanted to get them on board, so they were going on.
The glance that the official gave me as he turned the radio down kind of raised some alarm bells, but I just put it down to a sense of paranoia on my part. Each bag was quite heavy. It held about 25 kilos of cocaine. It was quite heavy work, really.
The carrying of the bags onto the boat was a real slick operation. Just yogging them on the boat, you know, and just chucking them.
As part of the master strategy to avoid police detection, it had been felt necessary and instructed from Frank's end that when handling this cargo, we should wear wonderful pink kitchen gloves.
Our rubber gloves helped immensely, yeah, you know. They made us look like a right couple of idiots, and that's it, they didn't help at all. the surprise was how actually big it was.
Into each compartment we stuffed basically as much as that compartment was physically able to take. There was very little space left over, very, very little space.
We're full, you know what I mean? That's it, I don't know my room, we're full.
When I realised that the boat was full, or that at least the hiding places were full, then I thought, well, fine, you know, just let's pile whatever comes along on board, and if it fills up the accommodation spaces and we have to actually carry it on deck outside, let's go ahead and do it. This is just a nonsense. It's crazy. It's an absolute Keystone Cops type of stupidity. The next priority was return the car in order for the next consignment to be picked up. Once Dennis had gone off, then I sat there and just wondered, you know, here's another fine mess you've got yourself into. You know, this. What am I doing here? How has this come about? This is so crazy.
I was a bit more optimistic than Donald about that it would actually work still. Perhaps thinking, you know, we've got half of it on and nobody's come. Is there a chance, you know?
Once Dennis came back, looked at each other and said, do you fancy a pint? Yeah, right, let's go ashore and have a beer. But there was no point in sitting there babysitting 300 kilograms of cocaine. Let's have a beer in the meantime. And if someone came and decided to help themselves to 300 kilograms of cocaine, as far as I was concerned, they were more than welcome to it, and they could take the boat as well if they wished. Seemed a very, very long time ago, and almost a world away, since that phone call had come to me in Hartlepool. It was quite amazing as where we now were. We suddenly became aware of vehicles. The first vehicle was immediately followed by another one, and then another, and then a larger vehicle. Shook hands with Dennis and said, basically, it's been nice knowing you.
That was a frightening bit, I think. When you see guys in combat, not so much the guns, but the combat uniform, you think, oh.
Now happening. That's it. The first vehicle stopped and the window was rolled down and a person in civilian clothes asked, are you from the Yacht Pulse? We said, yes we are.
Do you know why I'm stopping you? We said, no, we don't know why you're stopping us, you know. Why? He said, you know. I'll turn around and we'll go back.
The convoy then began to drive at walking pace back round the marina towards the boat.
So we get on the boat, me and Donald, and I think about six or seven of these National Guard, big rifles and that, you know. We just pulled both apart. They're saying, where is it we're going to smash the boat up? Well, we don't know where it is, do we? Where's what, you know what I mean? And I think it took them 3 seconds or something like that, 4 seconds to find the first packet, you know.
We have found cocaine on this vessel, and you're therefore under arrest.
And that's when they took us off the boat, and handcuffed us.
That was not a pleasant feeling.
It was finished. It was like, right, let's move on to another chapter.
As we drove away, one of the troops looked at me and he said, I feel Very sorry, you. You 24 years prison. It's like a fist in the stomach. I had a fairly clear sense that I would most likely die in the prison.
I think I started thinking about my family and Burnley, and I knew I was going to get through it, but I weren't really sure about my dad, and I weren't really sure about my sister and my brother. You know, what done to them? And that's really, you know, I thought, well, you know, I've destroyed these people, and I did.
A sense of unreality creeps into the situation. It's almost like watching it from the outside, watching a movie.
He came in broken English. He said, "If you behave, we'll behave. If you don't behave, we won't behave. If you run away, we'll shoot you. But we won't shoot you in the leg. We'll not hurt you. You'll be shot."
That was the first time that one heard the sound of a prison door closing. And yeah, that's a sound that has a special significance of freedom. Freedom is gone. Your life most assuredly had changed forever.
When we was arrested at the beginning, I got a chance to write to my father. I don't know if I said I was sorry.
I was very conscious of the possible effects that this would have on my family, and, you know, especially my daughter. These were the most difficult letters that I had ever had to write. It was devastating to think of what she was going to go through as a result of receiving this news.
Six weeks into it, they took us to court, and the interpreter said to us, right, are you pleading guilty?
We had been there almost up to our knees, literally, in cocaine, and there was no doubt that the prosecution had a very strong case against us.
We never thought we'd get on. I never thought I'd see my dad again, you know. If you plead guilty, then what they do, they give you a third off. We stood up, yes, we declare we are guilty and we admit culpability, and they took us away then. And after a good while, I don't know how long, not a good while, they said, right, we've sentenced you to 10 years, but what we're going to do, we'll give you a third off, 6 years at most.
To hear the words spoken, it's a real shock. I realised that I was going to miss my daughter's teenage years. The next time I saw her, she would be an adult. My daughter maintained communication up until the end of the year 2000. The way that news was being presented back home made it really impossible for her to be anything other than extremely angry and let down. So there was a real sense that now we were going to meet the real side of a Venezuelan prison. This would be the last time that we were able to gaze in everyday life. We didn't see the compound of San Antonio until we were almost on top of it.
We heard gunfire when we opened the door. I went, oh shit, like, here we go.
We saw a European passing, was a very tall and extremely emaciated Danish person, as we discovered, who approached the bars when he saw that there were Europeans there, and said, "Good afternoon, welcome to hell."
Cigarette?
No, I don't.
There are some cigarettes all smokers would like to cut out, but only Nicorette gum is clinically proven to help you cut down by more than 50%. And if you do, you'll find it easier to quit altogether. For every cigarette, there's a Nicorette.
Tesco Car Insurance. Switch to us by the 7th of November, and all new customers will receive up to £80 cash back. That's money you could put towards fueling the family car. Or just fueling the family, come to think of it. Tesco Car Insurance. Every little helps.
Witness the biggest cover-up in human history.
It's time to uncover the secret of the Da Vinci Code.
If you're out and about, and there's something you want to watch, it's simple. Set Sky Plus to record from your mobile. Sky. Entertainment your way.
And more is like no other credit card. Wherever and whenever you use it, you'll earn reward points to spend on the things you love at M&S. And more. The credit card that gives you a bit more M&S.
Never come between a woman and Heat magazine. With stars who are piling on the pounds. Fat, thin, make your mind up.
This week only at W.H. Smith, John Grisham's Innocent Man and Alan Titchmarsh's Novel Aloud are half price. Blooming marvellous. Spectacular offers. Think W.H. Smith.
We witnessed his genius.
Before dying, make your choice.
This Halloween, watch his legend grow. Prepare for three times the game. Three times the pain.
Suffering. You haven't seen anything yet.
Saw 3.
While walking after midnight, out in the moonlight, just like we used to do. I'm always walking after midnight, searching for you. I walk for miles along the highway. Well, that's just my way.
There's a power guy laying in there with his legs akimbo. And I don't know what he's doing, but that looked very natural.
It's celebrities.
It's a very full-on job.
But smell that. In beauty salon hell. Trust me, I'm a beauty therapist. After Banged Up Abroad on 5.
It was so very, very dangerous for every human being who was in that prison. There was a bit of a war going on between two parts of the prison. Really, there are no words to describe the utter horror and ruthlessness with which we were obliged to live in that place.
They had like an armed guard on roof to keep the other side of the prison from invading us, you know.
and the people on the guns were prisoners. And they didn't have homemade guns, they had guns. They had Brownings, they had Smith & Wessons, they had a Sig 9mm automatic.
The guns were under control, they were used to protect the people of that compound. But each prisoner carried his own knife, usually 6 inches to a foot long and absolutely evil looking.
People got shot, stabbed, killed, every day, you know.
That cold brutality.
He strangled a friend of mine waiting in front of me.
They then sewed up his mouth and hung him from the inside of a window.
Well, we don't know where we'll be. I think if not, I'd have probably hit somebody and getting shot or something like that. That's what would have happened in Margarita. I'd have belted somebody, gone nuts, and somebody had shot me. You know, I really believe that. I weren't coming out there, you know what I mean? I've done my life. No more. I mean, what more can you? I don't want anybody, you know.
We were literally fighting for our lives.
The third month, I got bad, you know, got real bad. There were shots going off. There was people in little, just little holes. You know, you think, oh, there's blood everywhere. Really, 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 blood everywhere.
The whole prison was so incredibly tense. Everyone just waiting and ready for the next group of people to be killed. The war between the two sides escalated. Prisoners broke out through the outside wall of their building on the other side of the prison. Then managed to get up onto to the roof and managed to throw a grenade through the windows of one of the cells.
And then you think, this is my life, isn't it? You know what I mean? You really know, you know, not just locked up, you're just in the shit, you know what I mean?
Everything was so alien to anything I had ever experienced before.
Alright, I needed to pay for my time, I did. You know, I did, and I did, I paid it. And here I am, you know, I mean, hello. But, didn't need to pay for it like that. The day I stepped back in England, just realised how cold it was. It must have hurt my teeth because I was smiling that much, you know, just relief. So I got home and my sister was there and saw my niece there I've never seen before. She was like, she's got 5. So and I went for a career. I've changed. I think about everybody else and then me. Before it was just me, you know. What I actually did was just damage my family. And that's wrong, isn't it? That's wrong.
To move outside these fenced compounds for the first time was just an incredible feeling of relief, release, and freedom. Last 6 months has been Chinese torture. I've now had 6 Christmases away from Britain, away from my family, my friends. To get back for Christmas is the next dream, like coming out of darkness into the light. For me, the saddest part of all of this is my knowledge of the effects that this has had on my daughter at a very vulnerable age in her life. There has not been a day gone by when I haven't thought of her. She is the person who has suffered perhaps more than anyone through this process. But 6 years have passed, and perhaps, I hope,
would be able to judge with a different perspective, that all is not black and white, good and bad.
What we did was totally and absolutely wrong and stupid and bad, you know, bad. But, you know, we are normal people that do things like this. And I'm not asking anybody forgiveness, I've paid mine with bells on, you know. So, just give us a chance, you know what I mean? Give us a chance.
I regret it deeply and thoroughly. I will regret it for the rest of my life. Because it has changed for my life forever. Nothing, nothing can ever be the same.
Well, that was the last in the series. Next Monday we'll look at the taboo subject of female-to-male domestic violence in Battered Men, Hidden Lives. That's at 10.
The last will and testament of Mr. Moore. I've